When's the last time you thought about what's in your well water? When's the last time you even thought about the bacteria that could be in your well water? Have you ever wondered what's the most common issue with well water when it comes to the quality of it? When's the last time you even thought about testing your well water? Do you own a home? And if you do, this might be important for you to know. All right, let's get into what's going on here. If you have a well, you're supposed to test it relatively frequently to make sure you know what's going on with the quality of your water. The EPA recommends you test your water at least once per year for nitrates and for bacteria. The reason they make this recommendation is this is probably the most common thing to change when it comes to your water and its quality. Sometimes it's naturally occurring, sometimes it's self-induced. Today, we're primarily going to be focusing on bacteria in the water because that is the most common issue I come across when it comes to water sampling. Part of my regular day-to-day job is collecting water samples and evaluating what's actually in people's water. This could be for both private residential houses or public stuff, such as a gas station or something to that effect. Believe it or not, a lot of places have to have their water tested regularly by law. When it comes to a public establishment, such as a gas station, a restaurant, things like that, not only could they impact the employees or the owners, but they can impact you, the public. And that's why we're required to make sure that we have good, safe water for all people of the public, and it takes somebody like me to make sure that things are looking good for you. When it comes to testing your water for bacteria, there's two different categories that that test is going to show up with. First one is going to be your E.coli, and the second one is going to be your total coliform. E.coli is the nasty one that we hear about in the news on a regular basis, usually when it comes to produce or some kind of food-related illness. Total coliform is the broad spectrum category of bacteria. It generally means anything that is bacteriological in nature. If you have E. coli in your water or on your food, it will have total coliform because total coliform is a smaller subsection of the grand total coliform. Total coliform is literally found just about everywhere. It could be on the trees behind us, in the dirt on the ground. It could also be on your clothes or even in your water. That's why you have to have regular testing of your water in order to figure out what's going on. Because if you don't know what's in your water, how can you keep yourself safe? Mostly when it comes to total coliform, you're not usually going to notice it all that often. Sometimes you can get an upset stomach and it can kind of make you feel a little bit ill. It's once we start getting into the E. coli territory, that's where it gets a lot more dangerous. If you have any coliform at all in your water, it's not considered safe and you have to chlorinate or sanitize it in some method to deal with that bacteria. Total coliform can be naturally occurring. It can just pop up in your well. It doesn't have to necessarily be that you ran the well over or cause any damage to the well, but it can sometimes show up, and if you don't deal with it, that's where you can start getting sick. Total coliform can be naturally occurring, and to no fault of your own, it can show up in the well. The most common way that I see coliform be introduced into a well is somebody gets a little bit too close to the lawnmower. Yeah, it sounds really stupid, but people hit their wells with the lawnmower all the time. You gotta think about it. Sometimes they're just a regular plastic pipe, or you might get a steel well casing. In the event of a steel well casing, if you smack it with your lawnmower, you're probably gonna have a little bit more of a problem with your lawnmower than you will with the well itself. With the steel casing, in the event that you smack it with a lawnmower, you're more likely gonna have a problem with the mower than you will the actual well. When it comes to PVC, it's only plastic pipe. So if you smack it with a mower doing a pretty decent clip, you're probably gonna destroy that PVC casing. So what's the problem with destroying the PVC casing? The casing's designed to prevent surface water from getting into the well. It's also designed to prevent things like sticks, leaves, bugs, grass trimmings from getting into your well. That's why it's also important to make sure you have a proper lid, but we'll get more into that in a few seconds. With the well casing, it's important to remember that you have to check it from time to time. On a steel casing, usually right on the bottom, is where you're gonna end up with most of your pitting and rot. Pitting's basically the rust, that like textured looking stuff that's on the side of the casing. Over time, you will eventually start to develop holes in the casing, and that's where surface water and debris can start to work its way into the well, thus contaminating it. The lid of the well is also important to make sure that you have a good, secure lid. It's vermin proof, and in some circumstances, it might even need to be flood proof. Flood proof caps are not super common, at least where I work, but they are prevalent enough. If you're within a floodplain or by water, the state wants you to have that well casing 24 inches up with a proper flood proof cap. They look a little bit goofy compared to a normal lid, so If you see a goofy lid, there's a good chance that might be floodproof. The most common style of lid that you'll see nowadays is the normal two-piece aluminum lid. Sometimes they're steel. If they're like a silver color, they're almost always aluminum. If they're greenish, it's usually gonna be some kind of like more durable steel. Most commonly you see aluminum because it's cheaper. The old style of lid are the one-piece caps. Now, I've talked about one-piece caps before. They're not good. If you have one, get rid of it. The problem with one-piece well caps is that they don't prevent bugs and debris from getting into your well. This can make it where it's way easier for ants and other critters to start getting in there, like earwigs and spiders, stuff like that. Those things will and do end up dying inside of your well. And when that happens, guess where they go? Down into it. When they go into your well, they're gonna start to decay, and that's where a lot of that bacteria can start to get introduced. If you're testing your water regularly, you should come across a bacteria hit at some point in the occupancy of your home. Usually it ends up being every 5 to 7 years we'll get a hit, especially with people who are doing regular testing. The next one's E. coli. This is much less common, and I usually only see failures on farms. Mainly it comes from when animals and farm animals are defecating near the actual well itself. For whatever reason, I keep seeing people put their wells in like horse pastures, goat pastures, near chicken coops. It's a good way to get nitrates in your water, but we'll deal with that in another video. Whenever you put a well in a pasture, you run a higher risk of those animals doing what animals do and using the facilities near the well. If you get enough of the creatures doing that, you run the risk of that stuff getting in to the well itself. E. coli is the nasty one that we always hear about in the news. It's not good. You don't want that in your water at all. The state of Maryland is a present or not present, pass-fail type of state. If you have any bacteria, doesn't matter how small it is, in the well, it will classify as a failure and you have to do something to fix it. There are ways to do tests to figure out how much bacteria is in the water. If you're in the Apple Valley area, way out west in Maryland, there's a lot of E. coli present in the aquifers or water wells, no matter what you do. Most commonly, you'll see ultraviolet lights in that area for that exact reason. Once you start getting to more central Maryland or the Piedmont range, if you have bacteria, what you need to do is fix the casing, fix the cap, and then you have to chlorinate the well. The state wants you to chlorinate to 100 parts per million to get rid of all of those nasty little things floating around in there that are gonna cause all sorts of headaches for you. When you do a chlorination, it's important to make sure that you're also running the water back into the well, recirculating it to make sure that all of that chlorinated water actually gets some contact time to the well casing and is able to dissolve any potential chlorine powder or pellets more thoroughly through the system. This chlorination recirculation makes it to where you can actually do a better job of killing off any of the bacteria that might be in there. If you've done everything correctly, you recirculated the water that was full of chlorine through the well, you should let the water sit for at least a day, 24 hours. You wanna make sure you run it through all the piping in the house and make sure it sits untouched. Just let it sit there, dwell. You need the dwell time for the chlorinated water in order to effectively kill off anything that's in there. After that, then you have to run that chlorine out. Our state usually recommends that you wanna have one good test after the chlorine's run out, and then you wanna wait 2 weeks or until you get a heavy rain to test again to make sure you get two consecutive passing tests. If you get two consecutive passing tests, it's considered safe and usable water. There are times though that chlorinating the well doesn't work, and that's okay. If that happens, all you need to do is introduce an ultraviolet light into the system. If you're gonna use an ultraviolet light, it's important to make sure that you have some kind of sediment filter or filtration prior to the UV light. Whether that's a carbon filter or a sediment filter or something to that effect, basically to get rid of any particulates that are floating around in the water. You don't want anything solid in the water because it can prevent the ultraviolet light from effectively doing its job and killing off any pathogens or bacteria. Once you get the UV light in, you're pretty much good to go. You just gotta make sure you change the bulb out fairly regularly. Remember, the main thing with this is you wanna test your water. Bacteria is the most common failure I see when it comes to water in any industry, whether it's residential, commercial, you name it, bacteria is very common. The problem is some of that bacteria, like E. coli, if you find it in your water, can get you very sick, and in some cases, be even life-threatening. If you're not testing, you have no idea what you have in your water. EPA recommends a test once a year for a bare minimum of bacteria and nitrates. Leave a comment below. How often are you actually testing your water at your house? Do you use the at-home test kits, or do you go and contact a lab to have them test your water? I may be biased, but I think that having a lab test your water is probably the most accurate way to do it. But I recognize that there are some issues when it comes to cost. All right, a lab's not very cheap. So if you can find a cheap test, at least do something to see what's going on in your water. Every now and again, sprinkle in a lab. Make sure you're getting it professionally looked at to make sure nothing silly is going on with your water. If you found this informative in any way, show me some support. Hit that like button. Hit the subscribe button. Doesn't cost you anything. I put out videos every day on the world of wells, septic, home improvement, DIY projects, anything that I'm doing in my life. I'm trying to show you ways that I can save money for you, ways that I save money for myself, different things, maybe give you an idea of a different way to help cut costs in your home, because I recognize that things are expensive and I'm here to try and help you out. Anyway, I will talk to you guys tomorrow. Have a good rest of your day.